In order to arrive there, to arrive where you are, to get from where you are not, you must go by a way wherein there is no ecstasy. You must go by a way which is the way of ignorance. In order to possess what you do not possess, you must go by the way of dispossession. In order to arrive at what you are not, you must go through the way in which you are not. And what you do not know is the only thing you know.
Hello, my name is James Cook. I'm an assistant professor of social science at the University of Maine at Augusta, and welcome to the third week of undergraduate criminology at UMA. I've brought you out here in a rural setting, one of the common rural settings in Maine, to ask you to contemplate that poem I just read about T.S. Eliot, to think about what you know about crime. I think I hope I've brought you along to this point in the third week of the criminology course in which you're asking a lot of questions, having a lot of doubts, feeling that perhaps there's a lot that you don't know about crime and about criminology, perhaps despairing of being able to know anything about it. After all, we spent the last week engaging in a review of moral panics in which people become convinced that there is a satanic cult across the nation that is sacrificing people, sacrificing babies. We have encountered people who have become convinced that there is a nationwide conspiracy of daycare providers sexually abusing children. And to this day, we encounter every Halloween reminders of the moral panic that our Halloween candy is dangerous, perhaps poisonous, because there are people out to get us. None of these three particular instances is true, although, of course, throughout history, there have been cults of people and religions who have hurt people. There has been a great deal of sexual abuse in our society, and people do poison one another from time to time. These particular instances regarding particular cases in which people became convinced that there were crimes when there were no crimes, however, should lead us to a position of doubt. When people tell stories from a place of seeming conviction, when people are convinced of the veracity of what they're saying, when we have very personal opinions about what is right and what is wrong, it becomes easy for us to see that as evidence of a universal. But crimes and the way we think about crimes are not universal. Almost no crime that we can think of, even Anthony Walsh's, your textbook author's, Mala in Se examples, are ones that have exceptions in a number of times and places. And some stories about crime, who engages in crime, who is the victim of crime, just turn out not to be true. So how do we move on from here? That is the goal of this week in the course. It's my goal to start bringing you from this position of doubt, of not knowing everything that we thought was obvious, to start to piece together a method for getting at least a better grip on what is happening in this country and in this world regarding the human act of crime.
I'm here in this rural setting in Maine today to invite you to think about what you feel you know and what you actually know about rural versus urban rates of crime. There is a common perception that the rural crime rate is lower than the urban crime rate, but how do we know this to be true? Is it from personal experience? Is it from the stories we hear? Our own personal experience, while certainly reliable in describing our own personal lives, is an unreliable way of measuring the diversity of experience that people have across billions and billions and billions of lives. The stories we hear, I hope that from last week you come to appreciate that stories can be very unreliable. So what can we begin to cling to as a source of truth, of accuracy in describing crime? Well, how about the uniform crime reports? As you know from your text, the uniform crime reports since the first third of the 20th century have been a way to describe different acts in a uniform fashion from places across the United States of America. And these uniform crime reports show consistently higher crime rates for urban areas than for rural areas. But why? And are these counts entirely accurate? Well, possibly not. There are a few findings in the research literature that cast some doubt on the extent, at least, of the rural-urban difference. Barry Ruback and Kim Menard, for instance, in 2001, found that rates of sexual victimization were higher in rural counties than in urban counties. More dangerous. But yet that reports of sexual victimization were higher in urban counties than in rural counties. Reports higher in urban counties, but actual victimization rates higher in rural counties. Janena Wing, in describing Idaho crime victimization survey results, a survey of victims, to uniform crime report results, finds that property and violent crime occurrences were reported less often in rural areas of Idaho than in urban areas. So these are just two of a number of studies that show that the kind of reporting or the extent of reporting of crimes is different for rural and urban areas. Why? Well, one reason may be that police officers are less likely to encounter crimes in rural areas because people are stretched out over wider areas, and so are the law enforcement officers. A second reason may be that rural communities are less likely to report acts as crimes. According to Timothy Carter, Ralph Weisheit, Joseph Donnermeyer, in various pieces of research, they have indicated that in smaller communities in which more residents know one another, there may be extra legal means outside the criminal justice system of handling deviant acts through the coordination of parents in the case of wayward youth, working together with neighbors and schools. That may be a more common act than referring young people to the criminal justice system. According to Ralph Weisheit and Joseph Donnermeyer in 2000, in Criminal Justice 2000 Series Volume 1, rural law enforcement officers report that the residents there tend to resolve problems of victimization on their own without calling law enforcement officers, where crime is often seen as an interpersonal matter to be handled interpersonally and not a formal matter of violation to be handled by the criminal justice system. As Weisheit, Falcone, and Wells in 1994 report, there is a greater reliance on informal social control in the rural environment. This is an assertion of a cultural shift. It's also possible, according to Joseph Donnermeyer, perhaps the nation's primary expert on rural crime, that the rural-urban crime difference may be a statistical artifact. Consider this. Do more people who live in rural areas commute to work in urban areas or vice versa? Well, more people from rural areas go in to work in urban areas. While they are in those urban areas, they may be victimized in crimes. And that count in crime is counted in the urban tally, even though you have a rural person being victimized. That count goes on the top of a crime rate. What goes on the bottom of a crime rate? Well, the population. But the population is counted as the number of residents, which doesn't count all the people who commute into a major urban city every day, temporarily adding to the population. So you have a lower number on bottom than perhaps you might otherwise, and a higher number on top, apparently raising the crime rate in cities and making it seem much larger than the crime rate in rural areas. These are three different reasons why we might not want to believe so strongly that the huge rural-urban difference in the crime rate is actually as big as it seems.